Welcome to the Jevers Brief, only on Contra Radio Network.
Hello again, Intelligentsia. John Jeffers here on the Contra Radio Network. Jeffers Brief. What are we going to talk about? Well, we got a lot. Where do we start? Okay. Let's talk about everybody's favorite, unfavorite beer, Bud Light. Been reported today at Gateway Pundit that Bud Light has received the painful Star of Death from a major retailer. Now, it appears one of the world's largest retailers, that's the fifth largest retailer in the world, may eventually stop selling Bud Light. Now, Newsweek reported Tuesday that social media sleuths have discovered that America's most disgraced beer company has received Costco's Star of Death. Now, the Star of Death is a small asterisk located at the top right-hand corner of the item's price tags. Now, Costco uses this to signal a product will no longer be restocked once it is sold out. One Twitter user displayed an image showing Bud Light being sold at $14.97 for a 2 12-packs. The user said this meant the Costco was practically giving away Bud Light. Oh, yes. Now they're not revealing the exact locations of these stores. But there is now photographic evidence of the Star of Death. Now, this reported death blow comes as the woke beer company was hit with more embarrassing sales numbers. You know what? Hold on. I got to tell you. If I'm a stockholder and I got this ass clown, I can't remember what his name is. It's time for him to be fired, the board to be fired, get rid of him. That's just me. Because according to Nelson IQ data, Bud Light sales cratered 28% over the four-week period ending July 1. So that means for the, let's see, four-week period ending July 1, that's got to be all of June. And the number of units of beer sold was down over 31% compared to the same time last year. The Bud Light received even worse news earlier this week as a recent survey revealed the beer had crashed to 14th place in terms of popularity with the public. Yahoo notes this shift in popularity jeopardizes the livelihoods of the 65,000 people whose jobs are linked to Anheuser-Busch's success. Let me tell you something. You know what? If Anheuser-Busch was at all concerned with those 65,000 people and their jobs and their livelihoods, perhaps they should have thought well ahead before making some stupid move that they did. Business 101, rule one, don't piss off your customer base. Hey, there you go. That's just what I'm thinking. So Costco is the fifth largest retailer in the entire world. Just imagine how bad the carnage will get for Bud Light, or should they stop selling the product completely. Oh, it's just beginning. They've been trying and trying. You know, the thing is, they come up with these stupid commercials. They're not even smart. And they keep hiding and lying about whether they're gonna, about what they're going to do or not do. Screw you, Anheuser-Busch. Now, my friends, little something here. I'm going to ask you a rhetorical question. That means it's a question that really doesn't need an answer, but it's a question that will be asked. Was COVID-19 a Chinese military project? According to the website 1945.com, they have a new report that says yes.
Really?
Now, the article claims that scientists in Wuhan, working alongside the Chinese military, were combining the world's most deadly coronaviruses to create a new mutant virus just as the pandemic began. And it just happened to escape the lab.
Really?
You ever wonder how is it that all this crap originates in China? I've asked this question for years, since 2020. Anything fucked up in the biological world is coming out of China, and the question has to be asked why. What in the hell are they doing over there? Well, let me tell you. Editor's note, as with all things COVID-19, we respect our author's opinions and ideas on this issue, all of their ideas. So with that in mind, we present this new opinion piece. Note that 1945 promotes the free expression of ideas and does not take any editorial stance on COVID-19 or any issue. Debate is what we do, and we think best. So, a scathing report came out this past weekend from the Times UK that provides fresh evidence that the Wuhan lab in China was indeed the source of the coronavirus that put the country and the world in a holding pattern for over 2 years in some states and localities. Bench, what are you doing, puppy? It's okay. We'll go out in a little bit. The article claims that scientists in Wuhan, working alongside the Chinese military, were combining the world's most deadly coronaviruses to create a new mutant virus just as the pandemic began. Furthermore, the piece claims that the reason there is no published information on the work and that it was done in collaboration with researchers from the Chinese military, which was funding the research, and which they say was pushing or pursuing bioweapons. Really, you think? This might confirm what Donald Trump and the handful of others who had the guts to speak out against the convenient and yet highly implausible narrative proclaimed since the spring of 2020 that COVID-19 was leaked from the Wuhan Institute of Virology. On May 3rd, 2020, Mike Pompeo, then Secretary of State, told ABC's This Week that there was a significant amount of evidence that COVID-19 came from the lab. The role of the United States, the report in the Times UK interviewed U.S. State Department investigators who told the paper, quote, "My view is that the reason Mo Jian was covered up was due to military secrecy related to the Army's pursuit of dual-use capabilities in virological, biological weapons, and vaccines." Mo Jian refers to the mine shaft in Yunnan province in China, where researchers discovered a new type of coronavirus in 2016 that caused death with similar symptoms to SARS. Now, the article states a report that the gain-of-function research continued via the University of North Carolina, led by veteran virologist Ralph Baric, B-A-R-I-C. Wuhan collaboration, despite a moratorium for that type of research announced by Barack Obama earlier in the year. It continues to describe the tight-knit relationships between EcoHealth Alliance, headed by Peter Daszak, the National Institute of Health, the Defense Advanced Research Projects, that's DARPA, which is responsible for emerging technology for use by the military, and the Wuhan Institute for Virology. It also suggests Daszak lied about the lethality of the SARS virus that were the focal point of the research in Wuhan. Daszak continues to deny that the EcoHealth-related experiments were dangerous. A lawsuit was filed in 2022 against both Daszak and Barrick, claiming they are responsible for plaintiffs' deaths due to their involvement in funding the gain-of-function research. Let me tell you something. They would not have filed those lawsuits unless they had some good evidence that they can show to the jury. See, it's not just enough that you have to show the evidence to the jury, because the jury is going to be made up of 12 people like you and me. Some smarter, some dumber. Either way, you're going to have to take them by the hand, and you're going to have to explain it to them like they're third graders to make the evidence make sense if you're going to win this case. So according to some reports, three U.S. agencies that went unnamed but located in Florida are working together to criminally charge Dr. Anthony Fauci, head of the NIH, Barrick, and Daszak for racketeering, collusion in creating the Wuhan virus, and premeditated murder of thousands by remdesivir and the COVID vaccines. I said, it's one thing to have the evidence. It's another thing to explain it to people like they're third graders so they will absolutely understand it and think the way you think. So where's the press? Now, as infuriating as the commentary from the UK publication is, what is more enraging is why the press in the United States has chosen to all but ignore this report. If they ignore it, they condemn Obama, their hero. They condemn Biden, their hero. If they could get away and not condemn Biden and Obama and just nail Trump, they would do it like that overnight. But they can't. So, and this is another reason why the U.S. media is so bad and so untrustworthy. So for those of you listeners out there in the intelligentsia, is why I like to use Daily Mail. True, they will publish anything. I don't care. I think I'm pretty smart. I think I can figure out, you know, what I want to say, what I want to do, what I want to believe in. Just put it out there. Some stuff, don't care. Don't know, don't care. So, where are the headlines? Where is the media outrage, something the industry is very adept at generating? Is there not even a smidge of curiosity to investigate this further? You can enter every combination of COVID, lab leak, Wuhan lab, UK Times, investigation, etc. into a search engine that you can possibly think of, and you'll barely get a hit. Now, initially heard about the report from the Morning Wire podcast and had to dig to find that. So the latest coverage in mainstream media that we could find on the topic was on March 17th, 2023, believe it or not, it's the New York Times, stated that the origin of the coronavirus remains a subject of intense scientific scrutiny and even more intense political debate, end quote. Conclusive evidence is hard to come by, the New York Times stated, and the nation's intelligence officials are split. No, they are not. UK Times report seems to prove differently. Now, furthermore, the New York Times pushed the ridiculous new claim from the most trusted organization in health, the World Health Organization, which, like our own CDC, has been politically compromised and not to be trusted. So the World Health Organization, which suggested a wild animal known as a raccoon dog. Yes, a raccoon dog. Have no idea. Never seen one. Could. A raccoon dog. What the hell? And yet, we got people of college educations going, that's right. That's a raccoon dog. Fuck you. You lunatic. How stupid are we? Well, there is some out there that will believe it. could have served as an intermediate host for the virus, allowing it to spread through the market. What is that? Wait, that's a raccoon dog. Bring it over here. What the hell? I mean, seriously, a raccoon dog? This is the same organization that praised China for its speed in identifying the virus and openness to share information with WHO and other countries. That's because they leaked it. They knew exactly what they had. This was not some big discovery. Meanwhile, America's complacency keeps growing. So given the massive amounts of outrage over non-mask compliant adults, raccoon dog, what the fuck? Yes, you're not wearing a mask. And those who refuse to be injected with what amounted to be an experimental vaccine, it's shocking how willing the American public is to turn the other cheek when it comes to damning evidence, indicting those who engage in grossly negligent and at best criminal at worst activity pertaining to the COVID-19 pandemic. Meanwhile, the public will gorge on politically motivated prosecutions against Donald Trump, while those who engage in similar activity gleefully proclaim impunity. It's a sad day when citizens lose all curiosity for the truth in the name of comfort and safety. I'm reminded of George Orwell's quote, "If you want to keep a secret, you must also hide it from yourself." So here we are, a public comprised of people who are perfectly happy to keep damning secrets from themselves, no matter what the cost to society at large, even if it means sacrificing their own future. Jennifer Gilardi, thank you. This is a great article, and I like it. And I always, always like to give credit where credit is due. She is the a political and culture editor for the 1945.com. She also has a master's in public policy from Pepperdine and produces and hosts the podcast Connection with conversations that address health, culture, politics, and policy. Her pieces are also been published in the Epoch Times and the Pepperdine Policy Review. There you go. Yes, it is true. Raccoon dog. Thank God. I'm not making this up. All right. What's this one? Yeah. Hold on. All right. Let me take a little bit of a break here. We come back, we're gonna do some. You guys are gonna love it. In the meantime, about a little Hair of the Dog by Nazareth. Hair of the Dog by Nazareth. That's right. One of those is I want to look up here real quick. Before. You know, sometimes I put stuff up. It's like, where did I put the... Don't know, and I go crazy. This is one of those times. I don't know. Wish I... Huh. I will find it. You can bet your bottom dollar on it.
From the DMZ to the NATO front, this is Contra Radio Network.
Indeed it is.
Have you or someone you know ever had a hard drive crash? Or maybe your cell phone or tablet died, taking all of your pictures with it? You've thought about backing up your data, but all of the plans out there cost too much money for just a little bit of storage space. Well, now there's a solution. Got backup? That's right, Got Backup will allow you to back up unlimited devices, up to 6 terabytes of data, for only $9.97 a month. And that's not all. You can earn commissions by referring friends and family, too. Got Backup is the only data storage center that allows you to earn income on your referrals. Check out Got Backup now. Log on to john-jeffers.com. That's john-jeffers.com. Log on now.
Yes, do that. Do that, do that. Okay. Hey, all right. This was one. I saw this yesterday and I'm thinking, oh, this has got to be a nice little piece for the show tomorrow. If you missed it, we got Christopher Wray, the FBI director. What a worm he is. And I do not like him at all in any way, shape, or form. He should have. He's not a good guy. And he has to face off against his nemesis, who's Matt Gaetz, from, I think he's First District of Florida. You guys, I'm going to play this. That's about 5 minutes long. And you're going to hear him just tear into Ray. Now, this is, yeah, this is... So hold on, here we go.
The American people need to understand what just happened. My Democrat colleague just asked the director of the FBI whether or not they are buying information about our fellow Americans. And the answer is, well, we'll just have to get back to you on that. Sounds really complicated, but I have other questions. I'm sitting here with my father. I will make certain that between the man sitting next to me and every person he knows and my ability to forever hold a grudge, that you will regret not following my direction. I am sitting here waiting for the call with my father. Sounds like a shakedown, doesn't it, Director?
I'm not going to get into commenting on that.
You seem deeply uncurious about it, don't you? Almost suspiciously uncurious. Are you protecting the Bidens?
Absolutely not. The FBI
You won't answer the question about whether or not that's a shakedown, and everybody knows why you won't answer it. Because to the millions of people who will see this, they know it is. And your inability to acknowledge that is deeply revealing about you. But let's go from the uncurious to the downright nosy. How many illegal FISA queries have occurred under your leadership of the FBI?
A lot.
Well, there are reports that have come out with different numbers about compliance incidents.
More than a million illegal ones? Because that's what the Inspector General said. The Inspector General said that in the 3.4 million of these queries, more than a million were in error. Do you have any basis to disagree with that assessment by the Inspector General?
I'm not sure actually that's a correct characterization of the Inspector General's findings on that.
Well, the Internet will remind you of that in moments. But let's now go to what the court said. The court said it was over 200,000 that have occurred on your watch. Do you have any basis to disagree with that assessment?
Again, I don't have the numbers. I sit here right now. What I can't
seems like a number you should know. How many times the FBI is breaking the law under your watch? Especially if it's like over a million. to not know that number, and I'm worried about your veracity on the subject as well. Play this. Play the video.
I just put a hold on for briefly. How do you not know? Oh, that's right, because if he knows, if he gives an answer, that makes him culpable as well. Let us continue.
Letters for investigation of the Capitol. I don't believe FISA is remotely implicated in our investigation.
So there, Senator Lee's asking you whether or not FISA was in any way involved in your January 6th investigation, and you say no. Was that truthful?
I said that I did not believe it was.
Okay, so now let's pull up what the court said, which was something a little different than what you said. So here, nope, that's not the right one. Yeah, here we go, right there. It says, the government has reported additional significant violations of the querying standard, including several relating to the January 6, 2021 breach of the Capitol. So I guess the question, Director Ray, is, did you not know when you were answering these questions that the FBI was engaging in these illegal searches, or did you perjure yourself to Senator Lee?
I certainly didn't perjure myself. At the time that I testified in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee, I didn't have that piece of information. I will add...
Well, that was a court order. You didn't have that piece of information because the court hadn't yet rendered a judgment. Did you not know when you gave the untruthful answer before Senator Lee that this was going on?
It was a truthful answer. I did not believe FISA had been involved in January 6th.
But it was. So you didn't... The answer is the FBI has broken so bad that people can go and engage in queries that when you come before the Congress to answer questions, you're like blissfully ignorant. You're blissfully ignorant as to the unlawful queries. You're blissfully ignorant as to the Biden shakedown regime. And it just seems like it gets into a kind of a creepy place as well. Go to our next image on what the court said. Like, just so the American people realize, the court has smacked you down, ruling FBI personnel apparently conducted queries for improper personal reasons. People were looking themselves up. They were looking their ex-lovers up. Who has been held accountable or fired as a consequence of the FBI using the FISA process as their, like, creepy personal snoop machine?
None.
There have been instances in which individuals have had disciplinary action and Amen. Who are no longer with it. I can't get into it here, but we can follow back up.
But
with
don't you that. See? Don't you see that that's kind of the thing, Director Ray, that you preside over the FBI that has the lowest level of trust in the FBI's history? People trusted the FBI more when J. Edgar Hoover was running the place than when you are. And the reason is because you don't give straight answers. You give answers that later a court deems aren't true. And then at the end of the day, you won't criticize an obvious shakedown when it's directly in front of us. And it appears as though you're whitewashing the conduct of corrupt people.
Respectfully, Congressman, in your home state of Florida, the number of people applying to come work for us and devote their lives working for us is up over 100%.
We're deeply proud of them, and they deserve better than you.
Time of the gentleman has expired.
There you go. I love it. They definitely deserve better than him. Ah. So, the key takeaways are absolutely not. Ray insists he is not protecting the Biden crime family after GOP Representative Matt Gaetz displays a shakedown WhatsApp message sent by Hunter Biden. Republicans tear into the 204,000 improper FISA queries carried out by the FBI. People were looking themselves up, looking up their ex-lovers, using the FISA process as their creepy personal snoop machine, said Gaetz. Another takeaway. Ray says he's not sure if there are undercover agents at the Capitol complex on January 6th, but it is ludicrous to say the agency was involved in the attack. I'm not so sure. Ray said he was aghast at memo about radical traditional Catholics from the Richmond field office, and the FBI was conducting an investigation. They've been doing that for months now. What the hell? It doesn't take that long to figure it out, boys and girls. They're just playing to run out the clock, hoping you forget. The conduct in the Durham report was totally unacceptable, said Ray. It must never be allowed to happen again. Well, gee, that's convincing. Next. Ray insists he is not biased against conservatives because he is one. He's more than just conservative. He's a swamp creature. He says, the idea that I am biased against conservatives seems somewhat insane to me, given my own personal background. Yes, your own personal background, sir, as a swamp creature. What, you think you just happen to magically rise above everyone else in the swamp to be picked to lead the FBI? Oh, please. You've been a swamp creature for many, many decades. And he says, the agency does not target pro-life protesters. Quote, most of the investigations that we've done since the Dobbs decision, 70% of them have been violence against pro-life facilities. Oh, he has that number. See. So there you go. There's your key. I saw that yesterday. I said, oh, no. Unfortunately, I cannot let this go. I cannot let it go. I must play this for my next. So there it is. Ah, okay. Something interesting here, my friends. I don't want to think here. Yeah. The AR-500. You ever hear of it? It's the most powerful gun you can legally buy, maybe? Now, some of you are going to start drooling when you hear this. The AR-500 is indeed a 50 caliber pistolized version of the AR-15 rifle. In not too distant decades past, if you wanted a large bore magnum power out of a handgun, you are going to be limited to revolvers such as the Smith & Wesson Model 2944 Magnum or the Smith & Wesson Model 5741 Magnum. For example, no semi-automatic pistol fits the category. Well, okay. Then in the 1970s, along came the 44 Automag, which used a bastardized, rimless version of the 44 Magnum cartridge. But in spite of the notoriety from the 1983 Dirty Hill film Sudden Impact, that gun was a commercial failure. Luckily for big bore auto pistol enthusiasts, the 1980s brought about the Desert Eagle, which was actual rimmed revolver cartridges in 41 and 44 mag alike, as well as the 475 Wildey Magnum and the LAR Grizzly 45 Winchester Magnum, both of which were designed as auto pistol cartridges from the ground up. Now, someone has figured out how to semi-automate, so to speak, the gargantuan Smith & Wesson 500 cartridge. Say hello to my little friend, to the AR-500 Auto Max. AR-500 is indeed a 50 caliber pistolized version of the AR-15 rifle. As per the official information page from the manufacturer, Bighorn Armory, the AR-500 pistol is a large frame AR chambered in the 500 Automax. This cartridge, in combination with our AR-500 pistol, puts an unparalleled amount of power into a pleasant shooting, rapid-firing, exceptionally compact firearm. This combination of size, maneuverability, and energy on target make the AR-500 pistol easily accessible and ready to handle almost any situation. I would think so. The 500 Automax is a rimless 500 Smith & Wesson Magnum that is easy to obtain or reload. A very versatile cartridge, it can be had in loaded ammunition with bullets ranging from 350 grains to an amazing 600 grains. The hand loader can utilize bullets ranging from 275 grains to 700 grains and almost any bullet type imaginable. Hard cast, jacketed hollow points, monolithic solids, etc. This is an unprecedented range of bullet weight and design, make the AR-500 suitable for anything from prairie dogs to pachyderms to Peterbilts. Truck stopping power and a platform weighing less than 10 pounds. Now, specifications include a weight of 8.5 pounds, thus putting truth to the manufacturer's claim of less than 10 pounds, a barrel length of 10 inches, an overall length of 32.25 inches, and a twist rate of, that's a 24, 1 in 24 twist rate. And it's a 3.5 pound trigger pull, a standard magazine capacity of 5 rounds with 9 rounders optionally available. Action materials made of hard anodized 775 aluminum and metal finishes of Hunter Black Nitride on stainless steel parts. Now, originally released in 2018, the gun was re-released in mid-2020 with updated and upgraded features such as the new blade pistol brace and the M-Lock handguard, and also an ambidextrous safety and charging handle. Company statement published in Police One declared the weapon to be ideal for SWAT officers, military or private security use, for vehicle carry, or as a powerful breaching weapon capable of clearing any obstruction, including bulletproof or more accurately, bullet-resistant glass. Now, gun writer Todd Bergen, in April 2020 article for ballisticmag.com, reported excellent accuracy results with the AR-500 while test firing it at the Echo Valley Training Center Jungle Walk Range. Utilizing a Trenchicon 8x variable combat optical gun sight with illuminated reticle, he was able to obtain consistent 1.75 inch or better groups at 100 yards. Not exactly, minute of angle, but still pretty accurate. And in spite of the massive bore size, Todd likened the perceived felt recoil to that of the 20 gauge shotgun level, thanks to the muzzle brake. Mr. Berggren also reported impressive impact effects on the target. The Bighorn Armory AR-500 proved devastating against range vehicles located on the EVTC's stepped berms. The 500 Automax loads had no issue penetrating windshield or car body to engage steel popper targets located inside. So you want to own your own. I told you, you guys are drooly. Wipe your chins. You look ridiculous. The manufacturer's website lists a manufacturer's suggested retail price base of $2,599. True Gun Value, meanwhile, notes that an AR-500 Automax pistol currently has too little sold data to calculate an average price. As for the ammo, Steinel Ammunition Company lists a box of 20 rounds of 350 grain jacketed hollow points at $52.99, while Underwood Ammo sells a box of 20 rounds of 420 grain extreme penetrator solid monolithic hunting and self-defense ammo at a whopping $96.99. Bring your checkbook. You're gonna. That was written by Christian Orr. He's a former Air Force officer and a former law enforcement officer, private military contractor with assignments, worked in Iraq, the UAE, Kosovo, Japan, Germany, and the Pentagon. So be it. So there it is. There you go. I have all kinds of fun stuff for you. I do. All right.
Have you or someone you know ever had a hard drive crash? Or maybe your cell phone or tablet died? taking all of your pictures with it. You've thought about backing up your data, but all of the plans out there cost too much money for just a little bit of storage space. Well, now there's a solution. Got backup? That's right, Got Backup will allow you to back up unlimited devices, up to 6 terabytes of data for only $9.97 a month. And that's not all. You can earn commissions by referring friends and family too. Got Backup is the only data storage center that allows you to earn income on your referrals. Check out Got Backup now. Log on to john-jeffers.com. That's john-jeffers.com. Log on now. From the DMZ to the NATO front, this is CRN.
Indeed it is. All right. A little something I caught here from the Telegram out of the UK by David Axe. Interesting. And he supposes that America would be destroyed in a fully hypersonic war despite the Kinjal-busting Patriot. He writes this. Yes. The Ukrainian military has had remarkable success with the American-made Patriot surface-to-air missiles and has even shot down some of Russia's vaunted Kinjal hypersonic missiles. No, this does not mean the Patriot or any other air defense system is ready to protect the United States and its allies from the most serious missile threats. Especially important to appreciate this reality in the aftermath of North Korea's test launch of a nuclear-capable ICBM on Wednesday, which was yesterday. Now, even after plinking a few Russian hypersonic munitions, Western missile defense systems are still more effective in theory than they are in reality. If Ukraine's repeated shootdowns of incoming Kinjals are any indication, Russia's non-nuclear hypersonic missiles aren't as scary as they have appeared at first. When the Kinjal, a 24-foot air-launched missile that travels up to 10 times the speed of sound, first appeared in 2018, Russian President Putin declared it impervious to all existing air defenses on account of its high speed. That makes sense. Well, Putin is either wrong or lying. Shortly after deploying their first Patriot batteries in May, the Ukrainians reportedly tweaked the Raytheon-built missile software to improve this intercession capability. Note here, it seems to me the Ukrainians are quite adept at tweaking software. They've been doing it all along. So then they got to work in making the case against the Kinjal and other Russian super weapons. On May 13th, the Patriot battery shot down 5 Russian warplanes and helicopters in the span of just a few minutes, while the aircraft were flying over southern Russia near the border with Ukraine. The crew of the same battery also claims to have shot down Russian drones, cruise missiles, and yes, Kinjals. Kill markings are visible on the Patriots' side in the Ukrainian Air Force promotional video. Ukraine's defense success here may also help to correct perceptions regarding the necessity and value of hypersonic weapons, which have been touted by some as essential at any price. Missile experts Alexander Montgomery and Amy Nelson wrote for the Brookings Institute in Washington, D.C. I think that's an excellent point. You know, it's kind of like having a man pad, which costs, you know, few hundred thousand dollars to make, to shoot down a fighter jet, which is a few million dollars. You know, that's the kind of thinking I think they're trying to go for. So anyways, so it might be tempting to conflate high-speed hypersonic missiles with ICBMs that also fly really, really fast. If a Patriot can shoot down a Mach 10 Kinzel, surely it or some other air defense system, the U.S. Army's Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense, or GMD missile, or the U.S. Navy's ship-launched SM-3, can also defend against a North Korean Waesong 18 ICBM and protect American and allied cities from nuclear attack, right? I mean, you would think that. Wrong. Probably. unlike Kinjal-style and atmosphere hypersonic missiles, an ICBM warhead boosts completely out of the atmosphere before re-entering it and speeding down toward its target at 20 times the speed of sound. That's at least twice as fast as a Kinjal during the final descent, and the extra atmospheric part of the journey is much higher. Of all interceptors, only the GMD can get high enough to stop the ICBM warheads in the middle part of their flight up in space, hence its name. It does this by lobbing an exo-atmospheric kill vehicle into the warhead's path. The EKV maneuvers itself precisely so that the speeding warhead crashes into it, destroying itself as much by its own kinetic energy as the EKVs. But the GMD has had a spotty test record at best. So even when the U.S. Missile Defense Agency successfully tested one of its 55-foot GMD missiles against what the agency claimed was an ICBM-like target over the Pacific Ocean back in 2017, critics were quick to point out that the target wasn't actually very realistic. Now, according to Laura Grigo, an analyst with the Union of Concerned Scientists in Massachusetts, the target reached a top speed of just Mach 17. That's thousands of miles per hour slower than a real ICBM. The unreliability of the GMD has led some U.S. politicians and officials to favor the Navy's SM-3. This is launched from Aegis warships, and like the GMD, it deploys an EKV into the target's path outside the atmosphere. When the U.S. needed to shoot down one of its own spy satellites, which had broken down in 2008, the SM-3 got the job and it delivered, destroying the satellite as planned. But the SM-3 is limited on the height it can get its EKV up to, and it was only intended to beat intermediate-range missiles when it was built, though it has been tested against ICBM-class targets in recent years. So in any case, threats have changed, and they're always going to. Rather than regular ICBM warheads soaring ballistically through space, the new menace today is hypersonic boost glide warheads such as Russia's Avangard. These are launched on an ICBM rocket stack, but much less time in space and much more time gliding through the atmosphere at high hypersonic speeds, jinking and maneuvering unpredictably as they come. Space EKVs can't deal with these, and they are much harder for in-atmosphere interceptors like the Patriot or the Naval SM-2 to deal with. That's not to say that U.S. interceptors are useless. They're not. They might offer defense against a very limited ICBM attack, the sort that North Korea might be able to make against the continental U.S. or U.S. allies such as Japan. But nobody seriously believes they could stop Russia's 1,000-strong nuclear fleet or China's rapidly growing ICBM force. Nonetheless, after spending hundreds of billions of dollars over many decades on ever more sophisticated missile defenses, U.S. militaries and its allies possess hundreds of air, sea, and ground-based launchers and many thousands of munitions that can intercept incoming enemy missiles with various capabilities. They can shoot down low and slow-flying cruise missiles, shorter-range ballistic missiles, and, of course, aircraft. They can even hit hypersonic missiles, as the Ukrainians have proved. That makes missile defense a key component of American and allied war plans for, say, a conflict with China over Taiwan. The Chinese People's Liberation Army Rocket Force has aimed thousands of non-nuclear cruise and ballistic missiles at Taiwan, U.S., and Japanese bases near Taiwan. Beijing's plan is to bombard Taiwanese defenses in order to soften them up in the early hours of a Chinese attempt to invade Taiwan, and to bombard American and Japanese bases in order to slow an American-led intervention on Taiwan's side. Patriots and other surface-to-air missile systems could swat away many of the Chinese missiles, blunting that key early bombardment, giving Taiwanese and allied troops a fighting chance to defend the island democracy. Just don't expect those SAMs to make any difference if a war over Taiwan or a major war between the two Koreas which drew in China, or war between NATO and Russia and Europe, escalates to a major strategic nuclear exchange. Both sides would still be destroyed. And it's still true now, as it was in 1949, the year the Soviet Union tested its first fission warhead and joined the United States as a nuclear power. The only way to win an atomic war is not to fight one in the first place. Yeah. So, there you go. Thought I'd put it out there. I don't know. What does it mean? I don't know. What it means is what it means. You can do your own takeaways. You're the intelligentsia. You're smart people. You are smart people. That's the way it is. All right, now. All right, that's it for this episode. The Jeffers Brief. Thanks for downloading. Thanks for listening. I appreciate it. In August, I told you I was going to wait, but I'm going to fire it here. I do believe we may have a new sponsor. A new sponsor for Contra Radio Network. And it may or may not take place. If it does, I think it's going to launch in August. So a couple weeks. We'll let you know more. If we do, great. All right. Thanks again. I'm John Jeffers. Get back up. Go get it. You need it. Can you really be a prepper if you don't even back up your data? Till next time, I'm John Jeffers. Thanks for listening.